Tonight I want to look at a topic called Breakthrough Faith. And I want to talk to you tonight about faith, because without faith it's impossible to please God. And in the vernacular, in the word, it says that faith is a substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things that you don't see. Now, I don't know if you're able to do this or not, but if you could just shine, can you take one of these little lights right here and just shine it out like you did during praise and worship? Is that possible? Is that not possible? Is that possible, Luke? Yeah, just shine one out towards the audience. We're just going to take a minute. I want to show you something. Just a little example. There we go. Okay, now just shine that light out. Shine it out. Can you make it a color? Can you put rays in it? Can you make the shape different? Can you see it? Okay, well, I can see it. Maybe you can't. But when I'm looking through the light, I'm actually seeing particles. Do you, any of you see that, or is it just me that sees that? You see, the light's shining, but when you put something up to it, if there was water right now, or amidst, like, I don't know if you've ever been to a rock concert with a light show. Anybody ever been? Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was just at one in Christmas, and they had this amazing light show in Ontario, and they put the mist, and the lights were everywhere, but when the mist came, the lights, you could actually see the light. You could see it. And it's like faith is like that. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things that you don't see. There's actually a substance of faith. If you could have spiritual eyes and you could see in the substance of the immaterial realm of the invisible world, you would actually see substance as your faith, as my faith begins to go and to call those things that be not as if they were, and to believe God for that which I don't have. Because faith is, in my terminology, the economic system of heaven. It moves the invisible. It moves God. God is a God of faith. By faith, we know the worlds were formed by the word of God. So we know that first there came thought in God, and then there came word, and then there came substance. And so it's the same thing with us. God wants us to believe him. He wants us to begin to release as a substance something wonderful called faith. And each of us has been given the measure of faith. And it takes from the invisible world that which we need and are believing for, and it brings it into our material, natural world. So tonight, I want to look at faith, and I want to look at something called breakthrough faith. Now, before I start, you know, I listen to Joel Osteen a lot, and on the radio, on satellite radio when I'm driving, because I figure I might as well listen to, you know, he's an apostle of hope. I might as well listen to good news. He always tells a joke. He always likes to start his sermons with a joke. So I'm probably the worst joke teller in the world because I laugh at my own jokes. And honey, could you get me a Kleenex? Because my nose is running. I was born with a runny nose. But I found a joke. So you want to hear a joke? Thanks. Is it okay if I'm just myself? Thank you. And I haven't prayed yet, have I? Oh, Lord, help. Thank you for what a delight it is to be in your presence and be with your people. As we open your word, open our eyes. Teach us tonight, Holy Spirit, as only you can. Amen. In Jesus' name. Okay, here's my joke. The ham sandwich. I found it online. There was a Jewish rabbi and a Catholic priest. I love that already. Really? And they're having a picnic together. That's even funnier. Yeah. And they're best friends, and they're just hanging out. And the Catholic priest, he has this amazing ham sandwich. And he is just eating on this ham sandwich. And he's enjoying it so much. And he looks at his friend, the rabbi, and he says, you know, this is such an amazing sandwich, and this ham is so good. I just wish you could just loosen your rules just for one time and just taste this sandwich. And the rabbi looks at him. He says, look, I know we're really good friends, but he says, I'm not going to do that. And the Catholic priest looks at his friend, the rabbi, and he says, well, is there ever a time that you would just loosen the rules and just taste this ham? And the rabbi looks at his friend, and he says, absolutely. He says, I'll do it at your wedding. Okay, did you get it? I thought that was funny. Yeah, do I need to explain it? No, y'all got it right. Yeah. Okay, well, we've looked at light shows and rock concerts, and now we're going to look at breakthrough faith. Because in every life, no matter how young or how old you are in the Lord or where you're at with God, you're going to have opportunities and times that you're going to feel like your faith isn't doing anything. And you're going to feel like circumstances are overwhelming and that God isn't hearing you and that life is standing still. And what in the world, God, am I into? And why is it getting worse and not better? And so I want to talk tonight, and I want to look at a person in the Word of God, a couple of people actually, and they were family members of Jesus. And, you know, there's just something about family. I don't know about your family, but my family, and I'm not talking about Jim and the kids, I'm talking about the Larsons and the Strums, where I come from. I'm a good Swedish girl, and I have some really crazy relatives. And family can just be different, don't you agree? You got some nutcases in your family. Well, Jesus isn't any different. In the genealogies of Jesus, there are some very interesting people, and yet nothing is in the Word of God by chance, but it's in by choice, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So tonight I want to look at an amazing woman. Her name was Tamar, and I want to look at an amazing man, his name was Judah, and I want to look at what happened in their lives, and how can they teach us, and how can they teach me how I can actually step into a place in faith where instead of barriers, there is breakthrough. Instead of frustration, there's joy. Instead of wanting to give up, I can keep going and believe God. And so I want to look tonight at breakthrough faith, and we're going to look at Judah. So we're going to be in the chapters of Genesis chapter 38, and we're pretty much going to stay there for a while. But let me tell you, what does it mean to have breakthrough faith? Now let's talk about the word breakthrough. The word breakthrough in our English dictionaries means to advance. It means to bust through a barrier, to discover what you didn't know, the ability to make progress, headway, and to achieve success. Let me say it again. It means to advance. It means to bust through a barrier, to discover what you didn't know. It's also the ability to make progress, headway, and to achieve success. And in my words, it's where you couldn't, where you shouldn't, but you do it anyway. Where you couldn't, you can. Where you shouldn't, you will. And you're going to do it anyway. No matter what is coming against you, no matter who says what, or what circumstances, whether they be natural or supernatural, seem to be keeping you from what God has for you, you are going to break through, and you're going to see victory, and you're going to see the promise of God, and you're going to see God come through as the victor in your life. That's breakthrough faith. So I want to look at a woman named Tamar, and I want to look at her father-in-law, and so we're going to look at Judah. So looking at Genesis chapter 38. Let's see if I can put my glasses on and find it here. Well, let me give you some history before we start. Judah is the fourth son of Leah, who is the first wife of Jacob, who is the son of Isaac and the grandson of Abraham. God says in the Old Testament, I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob was a twin. His older brother Esau was a reprobate. God didn't use Esau. But God loved Jacob, and Jacob was the one that ran away because he tricked his brother and he tricked his father. His name means deceiver, and God changed his name to Israel. Now, God's taking one man, Abraham, and out of one man came the miracle son, Isaac. And when Sarah and Abraham couldn't have Isaac, then they could have Isaac because he's the father of faith. Obviously, God is teaching us this is not about what we can do. It's about believing what God can do. And so Abraham has Isaac. Isaac has Esau and Jacob. Jacob is the one where the lineage is going through. And Jacob has two wives. He loved Rachel. He worked for Rachel for 7 years. She was beautiful. She had an older sister named Leah. Leah wasn't as pretty. She had weak eyes. We're not quite sure what that means. But Jacob loved Rachel, and Jacob worked for Rachel, worked for Laban for 7 years. And on the wedding night, Laban pulled a fast one on Jacob, the deceiver, and he switched Rachel with Leah. And Leah was actually the one that he betted on his marriage night. And so when he woke up in the morning, there's Leah, which isn't Rachel, and he's furious. And he didn't love Leah. He loved Rachel. And Laban comes back and says, well, listen, I'll make it right. Work for me another 7 years, and in a week, you can have Rachel as your wife. And so Jacob ended up with two wives. Now, God knew that Leah wasn't loved, and so he opened Leah's womb, and Leah had a bunch of kids. She had a pack of sons, and she had all these sons. She had four boys. The first one was Reuben, and the second one was Simeon, and then she had Levi, and then she has Judah. Now, every one of their names means something. Time doesn't permit me to tell you what their names mean except for Judas. Now, she's not loved by Jacob. She was snuck in there, so she is the unloved wife. And so she has Judah and her fourth son, and she says, I will praise God. And his name is the first time you see the word praise. Jacob means to praise God. That's what his name means. Jacob means praise. Now, it's interesting because names mean something, and God never puts anything in there by mistake. So Jacob grows up, and it turns out that Jacob actually, with his son Judah, now God is going to use Judah to bring forth the lineage of the Messiah, because that's God's plan through Abraham. And so we see that Jacob has Rachel and Leah, and then Rachel and Leah with their two handmaidens, Jacob gets them in bed too, and all four of these wives have 12 sons. But out of the 12 sons, which make up the 12 tribes of Israel, a nation, out of this nation, God is going to bring forth the Messiah. And out of the 12 tribes, the tribe that he chooses is the tribe of Judah, which means praise. And so Judah, his name means praise, is given the highest blessing of all the sons. Of all of them, Judah's given the blessing. And I want to look at that in Genesis 49, 8 through 12. And if we can just look at it on the overhead. Judah, you are the one. Now, Jacob is prophesying. He's about to die, and they're in Egypt now, and he's prophesying. And he says, Judah, you are the one whom your brothers shall praise. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's son shall bow down to you. Keep going. Judah, you're a lion's cub. With the prey, my son, you have gone high up the mountain. He stooped down, he crouched like a lion and like a lioness. Who dares provoke and rouse him? Keep going. This is all the blessing. The scepter or leadership shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until Shiloh, the Messiah, the peaceful one, comes to whom it belongs, and to him shall be the obedience of the people. So this is a tremendous blessing as Jacob is dying and he's blessing his 12 sons. What he is saying is that Judah, your brothers are going to praise you. You're going to triumph over your enemies. You're going to have royal authority. The scepter shall not depart from your hand. You are going to bring forth justice. The lawgiver will come forth out of Judah. Judah, you're going to bring forth a Davidic kingdom, a king named David. Judah, you're going to bring forth out of that the Messiah, Shiloh, the one that the world is waiting for. Judah, you will lead the tribes of Israel. And Judah in Exodus was camped on the east side. And God called Judah, the tribe of Judah, to lead Israel into the promised land. So Judah is blessed beyond all the brothers. Are you with me? And his name means to praise God. Because Leah said, now we'll praise God. So Judah and the brothers are jealous of Joseph, and they throw Joseph in a pit, and they sell him off to the Ishmaelites, and off Joseph goes to Egypt, and Judah leaves the family. So I'm going to fast forward the history now, okay, in chapter 38 of Genesis. So Judah leaves the family, and Judah's kind of had it, and there he is in chapter 38, and he's by himself, and he's got a friend, an Adamite. And Judah goes, and he meets a Canaanite woman that he falls in love with, and he marries her, and he has three sons. The first son he has is and then he has Onan, and then he has a third son, which is Shinah. And Judah finds a wife for his oldest son, This is chapter 38. Verse 6 says, and Judah took a wife for Ur, his firstborn, and her name was Tamar. So we see Tamar in chapter 38, verse 8. That's all we hear is just her name. We don't know much about her, but she marries Ur. But Ur, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord killed him. Yeah, well, how about that relative? So he's dead. Now the Levitical, or the law of their culture said that if you, the Levitical priesthood or any of that had not been yet established with Moses, but there was a Canaanite law, and there was a law that if your brother died, that the next son had the obligation to raise up a son in the dead brother's name. So being the custom and being the culture, Judah then gives the next son over to Tamar. And Judah said to Onan, go into your brother's wife and marry her and raise up an heir to your brother. Well, it gets a little dicey in here, so hang on. But Onan knew that the heir would not be his. And it came to pass that when he went into his brother's wife, which was Tamar, he wouldn't allow her to get pregnant. And you can read that for yourselves. I'm not going into that detail. But God got mad at him and killed him. So now we've got two dead sons. And we've got Judah, who has the big prophecy from his father Jacob, right? The highest prophecy. The one that Shiloh's coming out of. The one that Messiah is going to come forth in. The one where the scepter won't leave. The one that's going to lead all the tribes. And now we've got Judah. He's got a problem. He's only got one son left from this wife, and God's already killed two of them, and number three is young. So Tamar, this is what he tells Tamar. Now, poor Tamar, she hasn't done anything but just try to have a kid. So Tamar, he says to Tamar in chapter 38, and let's look at verse, let's see. I'm going off my notes. Let's look at verse 11. Then Judah said to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow in your father's house until my son Shelah is grown. So now he's promising her the third son. For he said, lest also he die like his brothers. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. So we see Tamar. And we see Tamar now is promised something. And she believes Judah, and she goes back to her father's house, and she lives there. Now, what has this got to do with breakthrough faith? Well, let's just look at this tonight, because there's three things from Judah and Tamar I want to look at. Now, God uses humanity. And have you ever noticed what rascals we really are? What a mess we really are as people? I mean, Judah lied. I mean, he threw his brother away, sold him off in slavery, and then he leaves the family. And then he marries somebody he shouldn't marry, and then he raises up wicked sons, and then God kills them all, except for the last one. And here's this woman who's minding her own business. She was chosen to be the wife, and there she is. And Tamar is sent now back to her father's house to be a widow. And so if I'm going to look at this crazy family, and I'm going to say, God, what can I learn from them? God's going to show me three things, and I want to pass them on to you, because I'm living this right now in my life. Because I got some barriers, and I've got some things I got to break through in my physical body. So what I'm preaching tonight to you is what I'm living every day. Is that all right? So let's just look at number one. Number one, if I'm going to have breakthrough faith, faith that's going to bust through a barrier, get me through circumstances that are impossible, faith that's going to take me to the next level, I'm going to have to, number one, praise God through the pain. Now, where did I get that? I got that from the dad, Judah. His name means praise God. When you and I are faced with circumstances and situations that are contrary to what you need in your life and what you're believing God for, you and I are going to have to learn what Judah's name means, and that is to praise God. And I'm adding another word to it, or a couple, through the pain. Because when you begin to believe God for something, you can just get ready that it's going to get worse and not better. Because there is an enemy in our lives who does not want us to have victory or to have what God wants, the promises of God in our lives. And so here we see that if number one is to praise God through the pain, let's take a look at this. And I just want to use one quick example of someone that we know in the Old Testament named Job. Now, there's nobody in here or on this planet that has probably had more problems than Job. Would you agree with that? I mean, Job lost his wealth. He lost his health. He lost his children. He lost, well, he wanted to get rid of his wife. I don't know if he wanted to get rid of his wife. I don't blame Job's wife, but she said, curse God and die. What's wrong with you, man? He lost everything he had, everything he worked for, everything he loved, everything he did, and he did no wrong. And yet Job didn't curse God. He praised God through the pain. And I just want to look at this verse. In Job chapter 1, if you look at 20 and 22, it says, then Job arose after he finds out everybody's gone, everybody's dead, all the camels, all the sheep, all the wealth, the kids are dead, everything's gone. And Job arose, tore his robe, shaved his head, and he fell to the ground and he worshiped. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin nor charge God with wrong. So instead of running from God, he ran to God, and he praised him through the pain. Now, it says that in James 1:3, it says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith works patience. Count it all joy. What is joy? Joy is an inner gladness and delight and pleasure. Happiness is outward circumstances. Oh, I'm going to Disneyland with the grandkids. I'm really happy about that. Yeah. Okay. I'm going to Hawaii. I'm happy about that. Whatever it is that you love to do and makes you happy, circumstances, you get excited about that. That's good. We're human. We're supposed to. But joy is an inner delight. It's an inner pleasure and gladness, regardless of what's going on the outside of your world. And God says, count it all joy. Be glad on the inside. Be full of pleasure. Be full of delight when you encounter various trials and testings of your faith. God, really? Really? God, I got a report that I went deaf in one ear. Really? Because of a bacteria, and now I can't hear out of this ear very well. And really, God, I just turned 65, and I feel like an old woman already, and now I'm going, huh? Could you talk a little louder? I went to the doctor last week, and they said to me, you are now officially hearing impaired. So my hearing impaired section, I love you. You are my heroes. Praise God through the pain. Count it all joy. What is God saying? He's saying, when you begin in a hard time, in a time when nothing is right, and you're not excited about anything, and it's getting worse and not better, if you can get up every morning, and if you can begin to be grateful for what you have, and to thank God for the things that are in your life. How about the blood of Jesus? How about a Savior that loved me so much that he went to Calvary, took on my sin? And how about the power that he has raising himself from the dead by the power of the Holy Spirit? How about the Holy Spirit lives in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. The power that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in me. How about the God that is the God that speaks those things that are not as if they were, and I'm made in his image, and now the power of God is in me, and I can speak those things that are not as if they were. How about if I just begin to have a little praise? Lord, I thank you that this dead nerve is healed in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father, that I can hear the birds singing. I thank you, God, and I begin to thank him, and I begin to praise him. Has anything changed? Not yet, but it will. And if it doesn't change this side of heaven, I'm not going to stop praising God because he's worthy of praise. Praise him through the pain. Judah, God shall be praised. Your name means it. So number one, learn it from the relatives. Praise him through the pain. Number two, let's move on. Sorry if I yell. You know what? A grandmother should not be yelling.
However, I have 10 grandsons, 2 granddaughters, and 1 great-granddaughter. I got to do some yelling with those boys. I babysat on Easter while everybody else is preaching. Let me tell you, I was about ready to kick them all out of the house. All right, praise with your pain. Number 2. Sure you didn't want a little... Okay, number 2. I'm going to have to... Faith that's going to break through is going to get back in the game. Faith that's going to break through is going to get back in the game. Going to get back in the game. What does that mean? It means that I'm not going to be content to sit on the sidelines, and I'm not going to settle for life the way it is. When I'm believing God for something, you see, I believe the enemy comes in to steal, to kill, and to destroy. John 10:10, God said that. So the enemy will come in, and he'll start to steal things from you. He'll start to shame you, or he'll start to confuse you, or he'll start to put guilt on you. He'll even pervert the word of God so that you begin to feel bad about being blessed, or bad about this, or bad about that. That he doesn't know how to do anything good. He is absolute evil. And when he starts to wear at you, and he starts to come at you, and you have faith for a while, you make your confessions, and you speak those things that are not as if they were, and you believe God, and then all of a sudden it starts to get worse and worse and worse. Before you know it, you start stepping back. And before you've even noticed, you're now on the sideline, and you are now settling for life the way it is, because you really don't want to stir up any more hornet's nest. You tried, it didn't work, must not be God's will. Are you hearing me? You settle. And the word settling means to accept significantly less than what you want or what you've been promised because you don't think you can have it. Maybe I should read that again. To settle means to accept significantly less than what you want or what you've been promised because you don't think you can have it. And he's out to erode our faith. He's after the word of God working in our lives. Listen, faith comes by hearing the word of God. When you know the will of God through his word, faith begins as a substance like that light. It begins to grow on the inside of you. And God gets bigger on the inside of you. And before you know it, God is getting so big that the things on the outside of your life, the circumstances in this natural world, start diminishing and stop intimidating and start becoming what they really are, subject to change and the word of God. But if the enemy can come in and if he can get you to settle and sit on the sidelines, then nothing's going to happen. You see, faith that's going to break through is going to get back in the game. What does that mean? It means you got to get up, you got to dust yourself off, and you got to get back in that game, and you got to play the game, and you got to believe again, and you got to do what you got to do, whatever it is, because are you going to let the devil define you, or are you going to let God define you? Now, let's look at Tamar. Now, enter Tamar. So here's Tamar. She's had one husband dead. Now she's got another one dead. She's just trying to have a baby. That's all she's trying to do. And these men are so wicked that they will keep her childless. Now, in that culture at that time, you didn't have children. You were considered cursed and not blessed. Women were for childbearing, and women were proud and blessed and happy and had an inheritance when they had sons and when they had children. Now here's this woman, and Judah has sent her back to her father, and he has told her to wait until Shelah is old enough for her to marry. So let's just look at this verse for a minute. I'm talking about getting back in the game. Don't settle. So let's look at this. Genesis 3:11. Then Judah said to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow in your father's house till my son Shelah is grown. For he said, lest he also die like his brothers. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. So there she is. She's living with her dad. She has no kids. She's been married twice. And all the dreams are gone. Everything's finished. Now she could have stayed there. She could have stayed with her dad. She could have just been a widow with no inheritance from the tribe, nothing, no children, no legacy. But Hagar wasn't willing to settle. Hagar. Did I say Hagar? Tamar wasn't willing to settle. Tamar was not willing to be a widow in widow's garments, and she was not willing to just stay with her father because this is what happens. She hatches a plan. Genesis, let's look at it. 38, we're back there. Let's look at verse 12 through 14. Now, in the process of time, the daughter of Shua, Judah's wife, died. So Judah loses his wife. Now he's lost his two sons, and he's lost the woman that he loved. She's dead, so everybody's dead but the one son. And Judah was comforted, and he went up to his sheep shears at Timnah. Now, he was comforted means the time of mourning was over. So he goes back to work, and he goes to the sheep shears at Timnah, and he's got that friend, the Adullam, whatever his name was, Hira, and he's with his friend. So these boys are not serving God. His wife is dead. The mourning time is over. And it says, and it was told Tamar, look, your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear his sheep. So she took off her widow's garments. She covered herself with a veil, and she wrapped herself up, and she sat in an open place, which was on the way to Timnah. So she knows where he's going, and she puts on the whole garment. The whore, the prostitute. She is now looking like a prostitute. That's what the Bible says. I didn't make that up. I'm not making her worse than she is. She veils herself, and she dresses like a prostitute. I think in today's vernacular in San Bernardino, that would be a hoe. Okay. For she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given to him as a wife. Now, she knows Judah's lied to me. He is not going to give me the third son. His wife is dead, and I want a child. Now, Judah has a prophecy that's about to come into his life, you know, 11 chapters later, and he's going to have the Messiah come out of his lineage. But he's got a bunch of dead sons, and he's got one son that God's already rejected. Now, God's got a word for Judah, and God needs Judah to have an heir and a son, does he not? Now, Tamar is discarded, and she has absolutely been put out to rest, and she's sitting on the bench. She didn't make the cut in the game, but she doesn't stay there. She decides that she's not going to let Judah define her life, and she's not going to stay a widow. She decides that she's going to have and go after what she wants, regardless of what it's going to cost her. You see, if you're going to have faith that's going to break through the barriers that want to stop the promise of God and stop your destiny and stop the plan of God for your life. I'm talking about tough faith. I'm talking about faith that first and foremost is going to have to praise through the pain. And number two, you're going to have to, faith that's going to have to get back in the game, and you are not going to settle or let the enemy or your circumstances define who you are. Because the enemy will define you and say, put on your widow's garments. Stay with your father. Go back to your old way. Your dreams are dead. You can't accomplish this. You cannot do this. Well, I have news. Faith is a substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things we don't see. Faith, if God isn't in faith, there is no faith. It's human faith. I got faith to sit on this piano bench right now, right here. I have faith that this piano bench is sturdy enough to hold my 135 pounds. That's a lot. I've gained a little weight. I have faith that there's nails and glue hanging on to this thing, and that when I sit on it, I'm not going to fall and make a fool of myself in front of you. That's human faith. You have faith to get on an airplane. I just came back from Miami with Jim, preaching at a pastor's conference and at a women's event. And I had faith to get on that airplane. I had faith to trust a pilot I never met. Never had lunch with him, didn't call him on the phone, didn't know his characteristics, didn't know his personality, didn't know his training, but I had faith to get on that plane and to go up 35,000 feet and faith for that pilot to get me to Miami. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You see, there's human faith and then there's supernatural faith. And faith that is going to break through barriers, breakthrough faith is going to take you and I doing something that is going to break through what Satan has told us we cannot have. Now, Tamar hatched a plan. She put on these prostitute garb and she covered her face and she meets Judah. And Judah wants her because Judah's, I'm not saying the word, but he's been comforted. He's done mourning for his wife. Judah's back being Judah. So what am I saying? Genesis 38, verse 15. So when Judah saw her, he thought she was a harlot because she had covered her face. Then he turned to her by the way and said, please, let me come into you. That means I want to have sex with you. For he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. She's got a pretty thick veil on. So she says, what will you give me that you may come into me? And he said, I'll send you a young goat from the flock. And she says, what will you give me as a pledge until you send it? And he says, what pledge shall I give you? She says, I want your signet and cord and your staff that is in your hand. And then he gave them to her and went into her, and she conceived by him. So here's what happens. He sees her. He doesn't see her face. He wants a prostitute. He hires her. She doesn't tell him who she is. He offers to pay her a goat. She says, well, I'll take the goat, but I need something to make sure you're going to give me the goat. He says, what do you want? She says, I want your Social Security number. I want your driver's license. And I want your American Express card. That's what she is saying. Because his signet, his staff, and his cord, that was his identity, who he was in the tribe, and his wealth and everything else. Now, Judah's not the sharpest knife in the drawer, even though he's got the biggest prophecy, and the man needs a woman, and he gives it to her. I mean, how stupid is that? Men, let's get our heads on straight here. Let grandma just tell you just for a minute, just take a step back and take a breath. Go take a cold shower. You're going to be okay. You'll get through it. Don't be giving out stuff you shouldn't be giving out. It'll send you right to hell and mess you up big time. Yeah, preach it, Nana. Remember, point two is get back in the game. Don't settle. Judah had defined her life, and Tamar said, I'm not going to let you define my life. If it takes a risk in everything I am, if it ruins my reputation, if it makes me look like a hoe, if it makes me seem like I have sinned, I am not going to leave without getting the promise of God. I'm going to have an heir. And Judah, you need a child. You don't know it yet, but God needed Judah to have a baby, and he needed Tamar to have this baby. So get back in the game. Don't let anybody define you. Don't let anybody tell you what you can't have when God says you can have it. You're going to have to break through. You're going to have to take a risk. You're going to have to be willing to get rid of your reputation. You're going to have to be willing to look like a fool, to be misunderstood. You're going to have to be willing to do all of that. But you can't stay on the bench. You got to get back in the game, and you got to be willing to do what you got to do. Man, I got to get going. So, now, 3 months later, Judah hears that his daughter-in-law Tamar's having a baby. She's pregnant. So let's look at Genesis chapter 38, verse 24. And it came to pass about 3 months later that Judah was told, saying, Tamar, your daughter-in-law, has played the harlot. Furthermore, she's with child by harlotry. So Judah said, bring her out and let her be burned. Way to go, Judah. Way to go. Let her be burned. She was brought out. She sent to her father-in-law, saying, by the man to whom these belong, I'm with child. And she said, please determine whose these are, the signet, the cord, and the staff. I've got your driver's license, Judah. I've got your Social Security card, and I happen to have your American Express. Now let's talk about who these belong to, and who am I pregnant with? And Judah says, she has been more righteous than I, because I did not give her to Shelah, my son. And he never knew her again. Now, he doesn't sleep with her again, but he clears her name, and he says, she's more righteous than I am. So, number one, you're going to have to praise through the pain. Faith that breaks through praises through the pain. Number two, faith that breaks through is going to have to get back in the game. And number three, praise that breaks through is going to have to move forward. What does that mean, to move forward? That's what I said to God when I was studying today. I said, move forward? What does that mean? Well, he says, well, duh, Deb. Let's think about that. The Holy Spirit can talk to me sometimes like that because I'm blonde, and he knows I need some very slow teaching. I'm not kidding. He said, well, to move forward means that you're not going backwards. And that's what I said. That's good, God. Oh, this is getting deep. It also means you can't stand still. When I say move forward, it means you have to go forward. You can't look back, you can't go back, and you can't stay on the bench. You got to move forward. So let's see, what does that mean? Well, let's look at Tamar's life. So let's move on with the story. We're almost done. Number three, move forward. It means you can't go back, you can't sit still, you got to get going. Genesis 38, chapter 38, verse 27. Now it came to pass at the time for giving birth. So now Tamar, she's pregnant, and she's got twins in her womb. Behold, twins were in her womb, and so it was when she was given birth that one put his hand out, and the midwife took a scarlet thread and bound it on his hand, saying, this one came out first. So, okay, I know all this imagery. This is quite a chapter, isn't it? I mean, from the beginning to the end, it's got a lot of stuff in there that you don't want anybody under 13 to even hear. Okay. So here she is in all her glory having a child, and she's having two, and the midwife sees a hand come out first. That's what it says. I didn't make this up. She puts a scarlet cord around it. Why? Because she wants to identify it. This one is first, right? So she identifies the hand. She puts a scarlet cord on it. Then it happened, verse 29. As he drew back his hand, that his brother came out unexpectedly. And she said, how did you break through? This breach be upon you. Therefore, his name was called Perez. Now, Perez means breakthrough. So now we got Judah, which means praise God. We got Tamar, who was the hoe that really wasn't a hoe. And now we got her son, Perez, which means breakthrough. So I don't know how that baby did it. I've had three children, and I know the birth canal is not exactly the widest place in the world. It's not a six-lane highway. It's not like you can pass. Put on your blinker and off you go. I know some of you men are shaking your heads. I did not write this. But have you noticed that God just gets in our face? He gets in our face with everything, from our sexual practices to our birthing to everything. Why? Because he made us and he knows us. What, you think you can hide from God? You think he doesn't know what you've been doing? He's God. He's not shocked about anything. But this child was in the back, and somehow this child moved forward and broke through and became the firstborn of the twins, Perez, which means breakthrough. And Perez is the baby that is in the genealogies of Jesus. It's not the twin with the scarlet cord on his hand. It's Perez who broke through the womb where there's not a six-lane highway, who moved forward, who pushed through, who broke through, was named breakthrough. And do you think maybe God's saying something to us, that there are some things about Jesus' genealogies and his family that can speak to the 21st century church with all the stuff we're facing in this modern world, and we can learn from their lives and their names? Number one, God says, you're going to have to praise me through the pain. You're going to have to praise God. Be grateful for what you have, not what you don't have. Because when you count it all joy, you release a supernatural energy and power that begins to overwhelm the darkness. And what couldn't be now can begin to start. Number two, you're going to have to be willing not to settle, not to sit on the bench, not to be willing to just have a mediocre life, not to keep that slave mentality that I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. And how could God ever use me? What could I ever do for the kingdom of God? How could I ever have a family? How could I ever have a good business? How could I ever, you add it in? Because Satan wants to steal that right out of your life. God says breakthrough faith isn't willing to sit on the bench, but get back in the game. Get back in the game, church. Kick yourselves in the butt, dust yourselves off, and get back in that game. My husband, when he was in high school, played baseball. He was a pitcher. Jim was in the minor leagues, and he went to the majors and washed out. He didn't make it, but he got to the minors. And he said that on his last game or his last season in high school, he said to me, and he told me this story, that as he was pitching, because he was a pitcher, he popped his arm, his pitching arm, and something desperately went wrong, and he injured his arm, and he couldn't even move it. Now, the scouts that were watching him heard about it, and they stopped coming to the games. And he knew that if he didn't do something, if he didn't get back in that game, he knew that he would never have a baseball career. So he started pitching at home, and it hurt him. Pitched, hurt, pitched, hurt, pitched, hurt, pitched, hurt, pitched, pitched, hurt, pitched, 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 hurt. And he kept pitching. And he convinced his coach to let him play the last game of the last season. And the scout, a scout heard about him going back into the game, and he came to watch him. Jim preached a shutout. Now, I don't know, have any idea what a shutout is, but apparently some of you would. I think it means nobody got on a base. It doesn't matter. It was a shutout, which is as good as you can get. And that scout signed him up, and he had a professional baseball career. But he had to get back in the game. He had to praise him through the pain. He had to do something that was impossible to do. Praise him through the pain. Get back in the game. Move forward. Now, I don't know how that baby moved forward. I have no idea how that baby moved forward. But you see, sometimes you can't look back and you can't go back. Sometimes circumstances are so bad and so hard that God's going to put you in a place where you can't even look back, because if you look back, there's an Egyptian army following you and they're about to take you out like the children of Israel. Now, do you remember that story? As Israel's coming out of Egypt, Pharaoh gets his head on straight and he says, "What have I done? I need those slaves back." And he takes his chariot, 600 of them. He takes his whole army and he chases them. Now, Israel is being led by God. I'm talking about moving forward. Israel's being led by God, and God does not lead them the short route. He takes them by way of the Red Sea. He does this on purpose to give himself honor. You can read about it in Exodus. So here's Israel, and they're just minding God, and there they are in the wilderness, and all of a sudden there's a big sea in front of them. God's led them to the sea, and they look back, and oh my gosh, here comes Pharaoh's army. They are screaming and scared as can be. Now, they can't go backward, because if they go back, they're going to die. And in front of them is the Red Sea. I'm talking about breakthrough faith that moves forward, that goes where you can't go, that is willing to believe God and step out into the water. If you got to get out of the boat and God says, come, you get out of that boat and you walk on that water. Let me show you. It's my last verse. It says here in Exodus 14, 15, and the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying to me? Because Moses is praying like crazy, crying out to God. What are we going to do? Here comes Pharaoh. He's crying to God. He's praying. You know, sometimes breakthrough faith says, no more praying. It's time to move forward. You've prayed. Now it's time to do something. You've prayed. It's time to get going. And this is what he says to Moses. I love this. He says, why do you cry to me? Stop praying, Moses. Tell the children of Israel to go forward. Go forward. Well, excuse me, God, in case you haven't seen, there is a sea in front of us, and if we go forward, all we're going to do is drown. You see, sometimes breakthrough faith is going to have to step into the water. It's going to have to step out of the boat. It's going to have to go forward when it looks like there's nothing to go forward to? Why would I believe God again? Why would I keep doing this? Why would I get my faith up again? Why would I do this? Go forward. Go forward. How did Perez go forward? I have no idea how that baby did it. But that baby moved that other baby out of the way, and that baby broke through. And he's in the genealogies of Jesus, and his name means breakthrough. Now, when those children of Israel looked at that Dead Sea, it was a sea. But when they walked into that Dead Sea and they moved forward, that sea started to change. And that sea started to congeal. And there were walls of water that were starting to form and dry land that they started to walk on. You see, when God says to move forward, God's ready to part the sea. God's ready to do something supernatural. God's ready to break through because you can't, but he can. The enemy wants you and he wants me to grow weary in my faith, in the battle, in the fight. He wants me to diminish. He wants me to be less than what I'm supposed to be. He wants me to be deaf of hearing and blind of sight and lame so I can't walk anymore. He will make you smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until there is nothing left of your life but mediocrity and broken dreams. And God is saying, you're my children. You have me on the inside of you. Anything you imagine with me is possible. But you're going to have to break through the barriers. You're going to have to break through the lies and the circumstances. You're going to have to, number one, praise me through the pain. You're going to have to, number two, get back in the game. And number three, you, my children, are going to have to move forward, even if it looks like you're going to drown, because I'm about to part what you need parted. I hope you got something out of tonight. I cannot believe how long I preached. My, my, my. You guys are amazing. And it is, it's so time to go. I'm so sorry. It's what happens when I don't preach much. I talk too much. But I did tell you a great joke. Breakthrough faith. The older I get, the more faith I need. You're never going to stop living by faith. There's never going to be a time where God's saying, okay, you don't have to believe me anymore. Now, you're going to grow in your faith. You're going to step into things you never believed you stepped into. You're going to do exploits in this generation that you never dreamed were possible. The dreams and the visions and the desires that you have in your heart. God says when you delight yourself in the Lord, he causes your desires to come forth because you and him become one. And you won't want what he doesn't want for you.